ما ونفعنا بما علمتنا إنك سميع مجيب الدعاء. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع وقلب لا يخشع ونفس لا تشبع ودعاء لا يسمع. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي آمين. So we're going to continue with, do you remember what we said 2 weeks ago? I don't know. Do you? Anything? What did we say about the Quran 2 weeks ago?
One of the keys was like learning to love the Quran.
Exactly. Alhamdulillah. So the first key, actually, these are keys. So the first key was to love the Quran. How do I love the Quran? If just to bring us back to what we talked about. How do I love the Quran?
Then you understand.
So when I understand it, huh?
And it's the words of the Allah.
When I miss it, signs I love it is when I miss reading the Quran or miss hearing or listening to the Quran. طيب. What's the other key? How do I love the Quran?
Give it
its time. The most important one that we went on, and then we said the dua. But you make a dua, you make a supplication. Allahumma ij'al al-Quran rabi'a qalbi. Oh Allah, make the Quran the spring of my heart. So this is one of the main things, is that you ask Allah to make you love the Quran. It's not something we are having it natural. It's not like a food I like. A food I like is usually something natural. I taste it once, then I love it, and then I start missing it. The Quran should be this way, but it's reality. It's not this way. We have so many other things that we are distracted because of. So I need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me this and to make me this. So the first thing is the love of the Quran. Second key, which we're going to... This second key has many, many subtitles. We're going to cover one of them, is... Question is, when you pick up the Quran, the question you're going to ask yourself, why I am reading? Why do we read the Quran? I'm sorry? So, okay, so I want to be guided, okay? Yeah, guided or to follow, okay? So it is an intimate conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah, that's part of the guiding, the guidance. Okay.
To get to know Allah.
Okay. So, okay, get to know Allah. I will put it three because to learn. We're going to say to learn. These are all general. Then we're going to come to one by one. So I read the Quran. Number one is because I want to be rewarded, because it's an act of worship, right? I mean, why do you read the Quran? You don't understand it at all. You don't understand a word from what you are reading, but you still read it and you're very happy. Why? Because Allah will reward you, right? So number one is because of a reward. Number two, because it's a private conversation, munajat. It's an intimate talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, there's no better way, and I always remind myself before anyone else, is when someone send you an email, a text, a letter, any form of communication, and they use your words, how is it going to make you feel? You smile right away. Right? So, for example, you always greet someone, like you say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and you always follow, how are you? You always do this. And somebody, when they are talking to you, they say exactly what you are saying. How are you going to feel? It's special, very happy. I was like, wow, she knows, she remembers. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you're reading the Quran, you're talking to Him in His words. Using His words. It's not like, Ya Rabbi, I love you. Ya Allah, please have mercy on me. That's all beautiful. But when I'm reading the Quran, it's the intimate talk personally, and it's only you and me and Him, subhanahu. Because I am reading the Quran alone. I'm reading the book. So I am having this intimate, private conversation with Allah. Number two, I'm looking for the reward, al-thawab. Number three, I want to learn. Number four, I want to exactly practice, and which can be any, this is not in the sequence, and it is basically as a cure, which a lot of us don't use this. It's a cure. Quran is a cure, is a medicine, and this is one of the things we need to learn. So this is most of the common reasons why we read the Quran. Most of us read the Quran, number one, because I want to be rewarded. It's an act of worship. That's why, again, you teach your child, and your child age is what, 4, 5, 3? And why do you start teaching them the Quran? They are clueless. They don't know what are they reading. Let alone some of us don't know what we are reading, but still we do it. So number one is the reward. So what I want to share before we go into this is, look at the Quran. I loved when I was preparing and I came to this. How do I glorify the Quran? And the scholar was saying it, of course, in the Arabic. It's beautifully, but I'm going to do my best to translate. He said, one of the ways that I will start to understand the Quran before even I am reading it, is glorify the Quran itself. Look at the book and look at your, if you have any 3-4 books in your home, or you have a huge library, the Quran, I have to look at it different than I'm looking at this book. So number one, ijlalul Quran, I have to bring in my heart the glory of the Quran, meaning the glory of the words in it. The glory and glorify the fact I'm looking at the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm looking. These are, you're going to tell me, I know this. I know is something, but when I think of it and I bring it, it's something else. It's just like when I say, I know how to do this. But then when I say, when I come to do it, I was like, let me bring the catalog and let's read to make it better. So let's look at it this way. I need, when I open the Quran, I want to glorify that book specifically. When I am looking at it, and then I am going to glorify the fact I am reading, and I am going to try my best to understand and spend time in looking at it and reflection. This is actually one of the main things we are missing in general. We do not spend time in the ayah itself, in the verse itself, and I'm going to come to this in detail. The verse itself, I don't spend time. We don't. All of us, young and old, know Arabic, don't know Arabic, you know, hafiz, you know it by heart, or you basically start. The only time I read it slowly is when I don't know it. When I don't know, it's like, what is this word? Let me look at it. But if I am reading, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, I'm going to read Al-Fatiha in 2 seconds, or maybe maximum a minute. So tadabbur, the reflection, is give yourself time. The last two is actually made me stop. And actually the scholar, I was listening to this, he was crying when he said this. He's, do you feel happy you have the Quran? And I was like, subhanAllah. He said, do you feel happy? Al-farahu bi. Do you look at it as what a blessing that the creator of this whole universe chose you and me to give us his words. Look at this. So here you are at home, right? Let's say you're downsizing. Let's say you're moving, right? And think of this. When we move, what do? We go through what we have, right? And then you normally divide them into categories. I don't need this. This is junk. This is very special and very dear to me. The very special and dear to me, I'm going to say, okay, I'm going to take it with me, number one, and number two, I'm going to give it. I'm going to write down that if I die, if forever, I'm going to give it to only special people, right? Look at your jewelry. Think of your jewelry, right? Who do you normally say, I'm going to give my jewelry?
Children.
Usually. And which children? You usually start with a daughter, and even if you have 3 or 4 daughters, you're going to think of this daughter, maybe she's not a jewelry kind, so I'm not going to give her the jewelry, because she's not going to go the value of it. But I'm going to give her, for example, whatever, something else I know she knows. Did you get what I'm trying to get? Basically, the fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the glorifying Allah, the creator of everything, his words, he chose it to give it to you and me, I need to be very happy. I need to be, may Allah forgive me, as happy as I am getting something I want, let alone way more happier. That he, subhanahu, chose you and me to give me with no effort, nothing, give me his book. And now these days even easier because it is translated in every language. So al-farahu bih, the major, the best, the highest, the most wanted, and we should be happy with ni'mah, blessing of Allah, the fact he gave us his book. That's, we need to bring it back to our hearts, because we don't have it. We take it granted. The Quran is there. You know, when do I read the Quran? Okay, either it's a habit every day, or someone is sick, or someone passed away. But I don't look at it as, this is something precious, and I am so happy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to me. And I need to look at the Quran again. I didn't open it yet. I believe in everything in it, even if I don't understand it. This is something, again, I have to bring it to my heart. Even if I'm not convinced, let's put it this way. Let's be very frank. I'm not convinced, right? I need to start with, I'm not convinced with the fact I believe in it. But I need to work hard on myself to see what it is, for example, somebody, physician, you come to me or you go to any physician and you're sick and they tell you, you know what, you need injection, right? What is my immediate response, myself included? I don't like it. I don't want it. Do I have to, right? Is there any other option? At the end, when someone looks at you and says, you need the injection, what do? You take it and you start convincing yourself. Now, of course, Quran is not the injection. Well, injection, in a way, it's a cure, right? But it's not painful like an injection. But my point is, I need to look at it that I believe in everything in it. This is the very important, and this needs to be taught to our children when they are this age, especially this day and age. You need to do, like we grew up when it was, we didn't have any doubt, even if we didn't understand, even if we did not read it daily. We didn't have a doubt about the Quran. It was unheard of. I need to bring this back to my children, and not when they are teenagers. It's too late. When they are two or three, and this is, we're going to come to one of the ways you do. So the first thing, I have not yet did anything, and then remember the ayah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam at the end of Surah Al-Hijr, and they said, there is, Allah said to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ. We have given you سَبْعِ الْمَثَانِي, the seventh that is repetitive, which most scholars say it's a Surah Al-Fatiha, وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ, and the glory Qur'an. And then next, the next is the amazing. لَا تَمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ إِلَى مَا مَتَّعْنَا بِهِ أَزْوَاجًا مِنْهُ. Don't look at what others have. You have the Qur'an. Did you get it? Don't look at dunya. This is to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. Don't look at what people have. And we all do, right? And he didn't say what. He said, لَا تَمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ إِلَى مَا مَتَّعْنَا بِهِ أَزْوَاجًا مِنْهُ. زَهْرَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. The glory and the beauty of this life. Before that, we gave you the Quran. I need to bring this back to my life. We don't. Subhanallah. And I'm talking about myself. I'm not talking about anybody else. It's the fact I have the Quran. The fact I was given. The fact I can read it. The fact I, if I put effort, I will understand it. And I say this to everyone. If I put effort to it, as I put effort for anything else in my life, which we all do, I for sure will understand it. Because as I said to myself before anyone else, if anybody can understand, I can. If anybody memorized it, I can. If anyone can live by it, I can. You know what I'm saying? So bring this back again every time. Remind yourself, ذكر فإن الذكرى تنفع المؤمنين. Remind yourself, reminder benefit the believers. Meaning, don't say, I know. I know you know, and I know I know. But I just don't remember it. You know what I'm saying? Bring it back. Again, I'll give an example. Every time I talk to people about try to drink more water, what do they tell you? Many reasons. I don't like it. I don't remember. I'm sorry, it makes me uncomfortable, or it makes some people say it makes me feel nauseous. Some people say it makes me go to the bathroom a lot, right? But then you keep telling them the benefits, the benefits, the benefits. You keep reminding them. And it's like, how do I do that? Right? One of the easy way I tell patients is just put the bottles of water in front of you in the morning. And you say, by the end of the day, I need to drink these. By the end of the day, within a week, you'll do it. Because you, literally, these are practical examples. Because you are, what are you doing? You're reminding yourself. It's in front of you. I say, put it on the kitchen counter. Put these small bottles, count them, you know, because people tell you 8 cups a day. You say, what? 8? And then I said, put the 8 and see how you will do it. Allah is exalted. Now, the difference between water and Quran is huge. But the main thing is, when you are trying to read the Quran, there is a force helping you. And that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's helping you because it is His book. So the first key is loving. The second key is bring back why you are reading. First one in why you are reading, and this is what we're going to cover today, is knowledge. I want to learn. I am opening this book to learn. Same thing. When you open any book, let's talk. What is the common books you read these days? If any. Right. So, alhamdulillah, Quran. Right? But that's the exceptions to the rule. Quran is not the most common book we read. Let's be very honest. Right? I'm sorry? Okay. Fine, sir. Very common. Social media. Social media, it depends who are you and where are you. right? Social media can be Snapchat, can be Instagram, can be Facebook, can be WhatsApp, can be messages. It depends, right? Bring back the same. What do you read in there? Everything. Rarely I read an ayah of the Quran, let alone the Quran itself. Meaning, I'm carrying my phone, right? Read all the WhatsApp, but when it comes to the Quran, something else comes up. True or false? And I have the Quran app in my phone. True, absolutely. So this is what I need to bring back. I need to bring back that lets me put some effort to read the Quran. And my goal is number one, I want to learn. What do you want to learn? What do you want to learn? Okay, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And somebody will answer you and says, I know everything about Allah. I don't need to read the Quran. I know Allah. People say this, or I, in me, the negative in me say this, right? So what do I need to learn about Allah? So when somebody, when myself tells me, and I'm not going to say human being, tells me, I know Allah. Okay. So when I don't get something, why do I get upset? Or let alone when I lose something, why do I get upset? Ma'ana, I know Allah. Right? I know Allah. True. I know Him very well. So when you tell me I know Allah very well, I'm going to tell you, so you know Allah is the one who gives, and Allah is the one who holds. Right? قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِنْ مَنْ تَشَاءُ تُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرُ إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. If you want to introduce someone to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, use one of the ayat is this one. It's in Surah Ali Imran. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ. Oh Allah, you are the owner of all the sovereign of all sovereignty. Or you are the king of all the kings. مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ. Or you are the owner of everything that can be owned. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ. تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ. You give sovereignty to whom you ever wish. وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ. And you strip it off from anyone you want. Mulk here could be money, could be power, could be knowledge, could be status, could be anything. You give it to whom you want and you strip it away. Take it away from anyone you want. And to izzu man tasha, and you glorify and you dignify whoever you want. Or to dhillu man tasha, and you abase or put down people. Okay, I know this, right? I know Allah very well. So when I lose something, why do I get upset? Why don't I say, Allah, You gave it to me and you took it back.
Because you don't know the knowledge of.
That's what I'm saying. That's why I need to read again and again and again. So the first knowledge the Quran is going to give me is the knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. Even if I say to myself, I know. If I ask any one of you, do you know Allah is Ar-Rahman? Allah is the merciful? The answer is, why you're asking me? Of course, ABCs. I was 2 years old when they taught me Al-Fatiha. Okay, so when I see externally in this world around me, in my home or outside, and I see things that is quote unquote, no rahmah in here. Why not immediately come in me and says, Ya Allah, you are Ar-Rahman. There is rahmah here. You are the one, you are the merciful. There is mercy here. I'm not seeing it. I can't deny it. You know what I'm saying? When I think this way, then the way I react to things is very different. So number one is al-ilm. I need to keep reminding myself of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And that's what the Quran teach me, not only the names of Allah. One of the things I learn about the stories in the Quran is who's Allah and how patient sabur Allah is and how Allah is capable of doing things, changing things, yes or no, right? And just read enough, if you read the story of Sayyidina Musa. This is one of the beautiful things you teach your children when the bedtime story is the stories of the prophets. And you don't have to go into the details, just get with every part of the story, a name of Allah is gonna come. SubhanAllah, I'm saying Sayyidina Musa because I was just reading it this morning. Right? And every part of the story, a name of Allah comes. قَالَ كَلَّا اِذْهَبَا فَإِنَّا مَعَكُمْ مُسْتَمِعُونَ. Sayyidina Musa talked to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, says, we are too scared to go to Fir'aun. Too scared. Right? And he said, don't. This is exactly what he said. Surah Al-Shu'ara. كَلَّا اِذْهَبَا بِآيَاتِنَا. Go with our signs. إِنَّا Allah مَعَكُمْ مُسْتَمِعُونَ. I am with you. I'm hearing. I'm hearing. So I have a child in the house. I'm going to teach him this ayah, and I'm going to say, Allah hears everything. Even if I'm not with you in the room, Allah is hearing you. If you're saying good things, He's hearing you. If you're not saying good, pleasant things, Allah is hearing you. Leave it at that stage. Years later, it's going to come back. You know what I am saying? So the Quran, first knowledge, is learning about Allah. Yes, but I need to give it a little bit more detail. And as I am saying this, I'm going to ask myself, do I really know the knowledge that is in the Quran? Do I? Now you're all saying no. Alhamdulillah. For example, I'm gonna share with you some of the nicest sayings of scholars. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he says, you want to learn? This is exactly what he says. أَرَدْتُمُ الْعِلْمِ, you want to learn? فَانْتُرُوا الْقُرْآنِ, go through the Quran. Go through the Quran, go through it. فَانْتُرُوا in the Arabic language meaning give it its due right, go in details. In it, you have the knowledge of everything before you, everything coming after you. Literally, somebody, subhanAllah, I don't remember this, but this subject, exactly what I'm saying, came up and says, so the Quran will teach me how to cook? Or the Quran will teach me what to eat?
Yes.
The answer is absolutely. And he said, really? What is going to teach me what to eat?
Eat halal stuff.
Yeah. كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. Everything is halal, unless Allah. And don't waste. Don't eat pork. Don't drink blood. That's what it is, right? Don't eat dead body, dead flesh. That's it. The rest is history. So the Quran not always come and spell out everything, but gives us principles. So he said, you want, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, you want to learn? Go through the Quran. I like the second one. Hassan ibn Ali is like the grandchild of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. He said the following, the people before you. Now remember, he's the grandchild of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. So this is about how many years later? Not thousands. And he was talking to the people around him. He said, the people before you, meaning the Sahaba before you, saw the Quran as a messages from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Messages. And that, now it's very much applied to our life, right? Because, and this is just to bring your attention, what is the average number we look at our phones per day? There was a study about that. Give a number. How often we look at our phones per day? 150 times. 150 times, right? And that we have notification, it is on, it's not on vibration, and we know if there was something we will get, but we still look, true or false, right? So he says, Sayyidina Hassan ibn Ali, the Quran to people, to the people before you, for sure before us, saw the Quran as messages from Allah. Did you get the point? Messages from Allah. What? How did they react to the message? They didn't delete it.
Sorry.
No, that's that, because that's reality. This is reality, right? Right? If a message, now think again, if a message come to you from somebody you really like, love, respect, dignitary, what are you going to do with the message?
Save it.
And then every now and then. How often are you going to read it? How often are you going to read the message? How often you will read the message, right? Oh, on and on and on. And you're going to start showing it to people, right? Messages from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They used to read it and reflect and understand it in the night. And they practice it in the morning. SubhanAllah, I love when I was reading this, like, Ya Allah, the same word, rasail, it's messages. The same. SubhanAllah, but it's so much the way we are living these days, right? Because we don't get letters anymore. The other day I was reading, one of the professions that is going to die within the next 25 years is? It's the post office, the mailman. No more. Right? How often now you go and pick up your mail? Versus before you used to wait, when is he coming? Right? So, rasailun min Allah, right? And another follower, he says, we have never asked the companions of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam about something, but they answered us from the Quran. Literally, this like these words when I read, I was like, Ya Allah. And he's saying this is a follower, and he was a faqih of Kufa. He was like very knowledgeable man in Kufa. You're talking about these legendary people. He said, I have never asked the companions about something, but they answered from the Quran. But we are way behind them. It's not about himself. لكن قصرنا علمنا. We are way behind us. We don't know, and we don't get what they are getting. And Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar says, take the Quran. I love these things. These will keep reminding me. And I would love, inshallah, maybe one person can do it, or maybe you or Nawal can do it, is take these small statements, make it as a reminders. Send it as reminders. Like we get all this WhatsApp messages, all the messages. Let's get these once a week. And I personally am a person who reads, and I have to read it, not only messages. So I probably will print it and make a small, you know, like things you hang it on your on the fridge or on your mirror or in the car. Alaykum bil Quran. This is what Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar says. Take the Quran. You will be asked about it. فَإِنَّكُمْ عَنْهُ تُسْأَلُونَ. You will be asked about it, and you will be rewarded by it. And it's enough admonition to the wise person. SubhanAllah, is enough admonition to the wise person. And Hassan al-Basri said the following. Now we need to know, who are we? If I tell you, if someone asks you, do you read the Quran? You're going to tell me yes. It's not. It doesn't matter how much you read. It's not. This issue is not here. So you are a person who people regard you as a person of the Quran, meaning you are from the people of the Quran, right? The people of the Quran are three categories. This is what he's saying, Al-Hasan al-Basri. Which one you are? Before I tell you what it is, which one we are? If I tell you which person of the Quran you are?
We try to read
them. Okay. What do you think? You're too scared to answer. Exactly. So he said, there's three people. There's people who took the Quran as their profession. So they teach and they live by it. And don't misunderstand this, right? Some people, that's their income source, right? And all scholars agreed, if that's your income source, that's fine, right? But that's what it is for them, the Quran. A profession, they teach and they live by it. So that's one group of people. The other group of people, the Hufadh, those who memorized it, they know every single letter, they know the page as it is, but they do not practice it. ضيعوا حدوده. They have not looked after or preserved the do's and don'ts in the Quran. The third group. And they said, I have to read this. They looked at the Quran as the cure, so they put it on the illness they have in their heart, and they make it like a garment. They are wearing it every day, the garment. So they brought the Quran to their heart and put it on the disease of their heart. Like when I have a wound and I go and bring, for example, a medicine. So they brought the Quran, put it on that disease in their heart, right? And they wore it as the tight garment around them. And they felt the fear and pushed by it all sorrow and sadness. And this is what he says. Those are the ones who by them and by their relationship with the Quran, the ummah will get benefit. And the ummah will get better. And he said, now that's the last one. And he said, that last group is more rare than the red gold. The red gold is very expensive, you know that. That group of people who, not necessarily huffal, so don't think I have to be a huffal. He didn't say they are huffal. They said, they looked at, for example, can I be that third person? You are looking at me, I was like, what are you talking about? I will answer simple. Give me a Muslim. I will say 90% of the Muslims know Al-Fatiha, right? No, Al-Fatiha, Surah Al-Fatiha. Do you find a Muslim doesn't know Surah Al-Fatiha? Very unlikely, right? Everybody knows Al-Fatiha. Bring Surah Al-Fatiha, which is more than enough, and apply this, that Surah Al-Fatiha will be the medicine, the tablet, the injection, right? The patch for the disease I have in my heart. Bring the commonest disease we have these days. What is the commonest disease we have these days? Not physical, I'm talking about. The main things internally that we are all suffering from. In general, people, what is it? For example, jealousy, greed, right? Depression, feeling down, not in peace. There is something missing in my life, you know, anxiety, all these, right? If I bring Al-Fatiha, right? If I bring, now I can say to some people, Fatiha is enough. No need for any other medication. But that doesn't mean we don't take other medications. I'm a physician. But I'm talking about if any Muslim knows Al-Fatiha, and let's say my main problem inside me, I am not living in peace. There's always things I worry about. Even if there is nothing I worry about the nothing. And there is people like that, right? Subhanallah. They either say it or you see it. Okay? Number one, I know what is the problem. Then I bring the Quran. I bring the Fatiha, right? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Done. Right? And I'm not saying just saying. Saying it, feeling it, keep reminding, Ya Allah, teach me. You are the merciful. So that worry I am worried about, tell me how it is. I mean, this is not something you do it once or twice. Something practice. I'm just bringing the principle itself that I need to be of the third person, which is, doesn't have to be I know the Quran all, but at least what I have, what I know, whether it's an ayah, or it's in a whole surah, or it's a part, whatever, I bring this, and two, look at what is my main problem and bring it and put it right there. Which one we are? Some of us, none. Neither we are in the profession of teaching, learning Quran. Neither of the group of the Huffaz, even if they don't know what they are really, nor are we from the people who are, whatever we know, we are putting it to cure ourselves, right? And the main thing, the Quran will, or actually, how do I know I learned the Quran? And I always ask myself this, actually, how do I know I learned this deen?
In your daily practice.
Exactly. That's very nice. Beautiful. In my daily practice. So I know I learned the Quran, and I'm gradually going into that third group. Right? Give me example. Give me an example. And I say, you know what? Wallahi, all this listening or reading or my dua, Allah has granted me. I can tell the Quran.
For me,
right. Again, Allah gave me tawakkul. Allah gave me tawakkul, reliance on Him. Allah made me patient. I need to think of me before and after, as we say, right? Before I learned and after I learned. Did I really, the Quran changed me? Because this is what it says. And one, Sayyidina also Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he says, enough knowledge. The knowledge you have is way more, is very enough, if it will take you to the fact of knowing Allah and having the awe from Allah. Then you know. Then you don't have to go into more. You know what I'm saying? When it translates to action. So reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? How do I know I have reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I've read all the Quran, I memorized, وَكَفَى بِهِ وَكِيلًا وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ, and rely on the one who the everlasting will never die. كَفَى بِهِ وَكِيلًا, enough is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for you. أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِكَافٍ عَبْدَهُ, isn't Allah enough for you, for His servant? All this you read, right? Okay, now bring it in reality. Reality. When do I need the reliance on Allah? Usually, but I'm talking about specific. I need you to start making the Quran as the garment. It's not general all the time, of course, but I'm talking about things happens in my life. Normally, when do I need the tawakkul? When everything else in life doesn't work.
That's right?
when things doesn't work, the phone, for example, I always bring this because that's very common for all of us, right? You drive your car and then you have a flat tire, right? The first thing you do in a flat tire is what? You look for your phone, right? Exactly. You look AAA or look for your insurance or you call somebody, right? No phone. You forget it at home or the phone is dead. Now show me your reliance on Allah. Yeah. Show me, number one, not external, not show me. I need to tell myself, show me your tawakkul. Number one, my feelings. What is going to happen here? And number two, my reaction. Then I know that the ayat, the verses I read and read and read, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي يَمُوتُ كَفَى بِهِ وَكِيلًا, all the one I'm reading, it became the disease, the medicine to the disease. Did you get my point? So, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله. محمد رسول الله. تام صلاة القائمة. محمد رسول الله. So back again, knowledge, I need to look into things I already know. Yani, don't start learning things you don't know. Bring things that you already know and then bring it on your life and see, this is where when you spend time alone or when you start reflecting on things you do during the day before you go to bed, what did I do? And then you start seeing, I did very well, I failed this, I should have done this better. No, this went very well. Look at this and always bring it from the Quran. One of the ways also, which I really loved it, is when you open the Quran, also about knowledge, put a goal for something to learn, right? What do you wanna, for example, what do you wanna learn from the Quran? This is the question you're gonna put to yourself. And you can put every month one goal or every year one goal, right? Give me one goal, you know, put a goal. Like, and when you put a goal, you will work for that goal, right? If you are looking for something, right, you'll find it. But if you open a cupboard accidentally, you probably will not see something, right? But if you are looking for it, you will see it. You get my point, right? So it's accidental, you're looking for a cup. You'll see the cup, even if the cup is up, because you can't keep looking. But if you opened the cupboard by mistake, you probably will not see the cup. So put a goal for you. Why don't I understand the Quran? Because I am shattered when I open the Quran. My brain is way more things. I'm going to say to myself, I'm going to look at whatever, which surah you are. I am going to look at, for example, one of the names, one of the characters of Allah. Or I'm going to look and see, does the Quran really have something called patient? Does it? And these days, again, it's very easy. Because you can do easily, Google search, get the ayat, go back to the Quran. So put a goal that you want to learn from the Quran. Other than I want the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do I want to learn from it? And this, especially in Ramadan, or especially when there is time off, or when you are listening. And some people learn the Quran and teach the Quran by subject, not by the surah, which is amazing. There was one teacher who lead Taraweeh by subject, not by the surah. How much they know the Quran? By the subject. So look at you, what do you need in your life in this moment, right? This moment I need to be grateful to Allah. I have everything I want, right? Look at where is gratefulness in the Quran, right? Where is Surah al-Shukr? for example. Is there something called Surah al-Shukr? There's a chapter in the Quran that talks about being grateful. Huh? Many places, Surah, chapter. Yeah, Surah al-Nahl, the bees. It's the Surah of the bounties of Allah. Bounties of Allah. So my point is, look at what do you need in your life now. For example, I want to memorize the Quran. I want to learn more about the Quran, right? I want to be successful in my life, right? I want to study hard and get a highest degree, and I want to go to this college or that college. Put that as a goal and see the virtues of knowledge in the Quran. And then you're going to say, wow. So when you read the Quran, to help you understand, put goals. Don't open it up and, okay, whatever. You know, sometimes say, okay, let's see. And then we just open. SubhanAllah. You know what? Casual. Casual. This is what I'm trying to change, bi-idhnillah, to myself before anyone else, is I move my relationship to the Quran from the casual reading, because I am reading, I'm going to get a reward, to the focused learning reading. That's a huge difference. One of the thing which this is especially for us, myself included, who are in the quote-unquote calling people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you know about the Quran, the more effective you are. And the best way I have seen it personally, change people or call people to Islam is through the Quran. But I cannot call people to something I don't know about. So when I go, especially when I go for interfaith, right? When I have non-Muslims with me, around me, which we all do. And we beautiful when you don't have to bring the ayah itself, but you bring the concept, right? I mean, I had this conversation very recently with a non-Muslim. They couldn't believe there is the mention of Mary in the Quran. May Allah be pleased with her. And I was like, absolutely, there's a whole chapter about her. And then literally, I couldn't believe even there's still non-Muslims don't know this. They don't. And Jesus, it's in the Quran. It's in your holy book. This is exactly how they asked me. In your holy book? I was like, yeah. And then imagine, yes, and you're very confident. And then somebody says, really, show me. Ah, now we have a problem. Right? So if you already know this, like, again, because we live in a surrounded by non-Muslims, I need to know these. So I'll make a simple search. Sayyidina Isa in the Quran. And bring one or two or three ayat. One or two. Right? And you know it well. If you memorize it, alhamdulillah, you know it well, then you are. So put goals when you're reading the Quran. What I want to learn, put subjects special you want to learn about the Quran. If you have children, teach them. One of the things I found, I always bring children's attention when I say this question, is give me the names of the animals in the Quran. The kids go banana, crazy. And then they start competing, right? SubhanAllah. I wouldn't say only children, even adults. They because it's like very simple, very nice. And they start numbering them, 1, 2, 3, 4, animals. And then next will be, after you realize, like, why this animal is mentioned, not the other animal. That animal has something Allah wants to teach me. It's not the name of the animal. It's something in that animal. Did you get the point? It's a book that there's a lot of knowledge I can learn from it. And I can definitely improve by it. Malik ibn Dinar asked this question, and I'm going to ask you all and ask myself. He says, the people of the Quran, what did the Quran implanted in your heart? What did it implant in your heart? And what is belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So it implanted in me the belief in Allah. And what does the belief in Allah mean? Connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran engraved in me, implanted in me, excuse me, a plant that I am seeing the leaves of Iman. Right. So the all goes to what your answer. So the plants of Allah, think of it as a plant. And you planted in your heart, right, the Iman, the faith itself. The plants of faith is going to come. Number one is obeying Allah, because I believe in Him. When I believe in Him, I believe in every character of Him, subhanahu, right? And what is the another leaf? Look at plants and leaf. What's the other leaf of Iman? Strength. Al-mu'min qawi, the person who believes in Allah truly is very strong, because you are very close to the source of strength, right? That doesn't mean if I am weak, my Iman is weak. I don't like that, right? Because people can take this in a negative way. But I will say, the closer I get to Allah, and in my heart, not externally only, I am stronger. I am more patient. I am more understanding. I am more loving. I'm more caring. I am more aware of me and my shortcomings, not the other people. So, ما زرع القرآن في قلوبكم? What did it plant, يا أهل القرآن? And he was asking to the people, what did it implant? And this is why there is a lot of talk these days is about, we need to move from teaching people to memorize the Quran to understand the Quran. And if we can do it, I mean, one of the schools there actually was that it's together. So the memorization may take 10 years, but it is together, comes together. Really, it's really make people change. What I want to leave with every one of you and everybody, take one ayah of the Quran today, each one of you. And this is different, right? And stop with this ayah. You know what stop is like? Write it down and look at it and see and see and see and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and what is this ayah is teaching you? If I ask you right now, what, give me an ayah. Each one is different. Ayah, one verse in the Quran. One verse in the Quran that will stop you when you hear it or bring your attention. Give me one. Anyone. Wallahu khayrul raziqin. Wallahu khayrul raziqin. It's not an ayah actually. It's an end of ayah, right? Allah is the best, the best, or the only one, if you want to use it even in a nicer, who can give sustenance. This stops you, right? And I'm sure it has an implication in your life. Right? For example, that's me. Allah. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu lima taquluna ma la taf'alun kabura maqtan 'inda Allah an taqulu ma la taf'alun. People who you believe, the iman, lima taquluna ma la taf'alun. Why do you say things you don't do it yourself? And I always say this to myself, number one, and number two, to mothers who have children. لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. You tell your children to do things and you don't do it. You tell your friends to do something, you don't do it. And then Allah tells you, كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. One of the most disguised and hated things to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you say what you don't do. So it has to be, you have to be, this actually scares me, this ayah. I was like, Ya Allah, and every time I hear it or I read it, Ya Allah, don't make me of those. Don't allow me to be of those, because sometimes we are and we're dragged to this. So stop, what they call it, waqfa, take time with one ayah of the Quran, one ayah that comes to your mind. Any ayah, even if you don't know the verse, just tell me the meaning. Ayah. I'm sorry? فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدُ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدُ. Ya Allah, your Lord, this is Surah Hud. The surah that made the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam hair go gray. Inna rabbaka fa'alun lima yurid. Your Lord is fa'al. He's not fa'al. He's not yaf'al. It's fa'al. Constantly, always able, capable of doing what he wants. Fa'alun lima yurid. Because the ayah comes after Allah describing that in a very beautiful, eloquent Arabic way, how the people of Jahannam will be in Jahannam and the people of Jannah will be in Jannah. Inna rabbuka fa. For eternity, time is unlimited. Inna rabbuka fa'alun lima yurid. He can do it. When I use this? That's the question. So here you are. Bring one. Wallah ladhi allahu. If we get this, whatever ayat Allah make us today remember. And bring these to our life. See your life in a week. If you believe, if I believe fully, إن ربك فعال لما يريد. Your Lord is capable of doing what he wants. I will never say it's impossible. The word impossible shouldn't be. Because ربك فعال لما يريد. I should say Allah is capable of everything. I say this even to my patients. Someone, terminal cancer. They told them there's no more hope. Right? And this is very common. This is medicine, right? And yes. So when you deliver this in news and you say, but... most important, رَبُّكَ فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدُ. And Allah can cure people. كُن فَيَكُون. One, say B, and it is B. See one ayah. See the knowledge? Knowledge, again, is you look at what personal relationship. Give me one more ayah, because that's how it's going to bring the ilm to you. One ayah or one meaning. Inna Allah ma'as sabirin. Inna Allah ma'as sabirin. I highly, highly recommend look into a sabr in the Quran. Only in the Quran. Look at the word sabr, sabirin, fasbiru, fasbir, be patient. Be from those of our patient. You be patient. This is to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. What is it in Allah ma'as sabir? How will I live in Allah ma'as sabir? Simple. Don't go to the death through diseases, right? How many of us lose our temper because of traffic light? Simple, right? Road rage is a huge issue these days, right? Road rage, young and old, right? The traffic light stays red for whatever. What is this? Never going to be green? And on and on and on, right? Or the person, absolutely, that's what I'm saying. It's road rage. People die of it, right? Or the person in front of you is on speed limit. 35, and it is 35. It's not even 36. Right? Absolutely. Always Allah tests you with this. The person, he or she, is right. That's the speed limit. They're not doing something wrong. But I and you are not used to it. Right? And since I am used to be under control, and I don't like not being under control, so I get upset. Inna Allah ma'as sabirin. Be patient. Allah is with those who are patient. Or even nicer, fasbir. وَمَا صَبْرُكَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. I love this even more. Be patient, and you say, it's very hard. It's very hard. And say, وَمَا صَبْرُكَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. Who's going to make you patient? It's Allah. تَصْبِر. See, that's knowledge. Everything you are now telling me, and we are discussing, this is knowledge. Give me one more, because that's going to make you look at like, this is not too hard. Give me one more ayah. One ayah. فَاسْتَغْفِرِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا. That's concept. The concept of istighfar. Right? So we had the concept of being patient, the concept of being faithful, the concept of being Allah is the one who gives sustenance. Now the last one, which is beautiful to end with, is Allah غَفَّار. غَفَّار or غَفُور or الْغَفُور. This is all in the Quran. Be forgiving. Forgiving. Always forgiving. Why do I need to stop at this ayah, right? Many ways. My relationship with Allah, and more to me, is my relationship with people. And you hear this a lot, young and old. I will never forgive this person. Yeah, I cannot. You don't know what they did to me. We always say, right? If we don't say it, we feel it, right? What was the ayah? Inna Allah ghafur rahim. Innahu huwa al-ghafur rahim. Innahu ghafur rahim. I say this to myself, how many mistakes you have done with Allah? I'm not talking about people, me personally, right? Right? How many things I did he doesn't like? How many times I disappointed him, subhana, right? And then, ghafur rahim. How do I know he's ghafur rahim? He still feeds me, he still gives me, he still makes me feel good, he still gives me the Quran, he still gives me children and dunya and everything. So I cannot be a fraction of this. What did they do to me is not what I did to Allah. I did not give them life. I did not give them sustenance. I did not give them everything they have. I'm not capable of doing everything I want. But he does. And he forgive. Why I cannot forgive? That's how you learn. That's how you learn.
I know a case where a mother knows that a person has sexually abused her daughter.
Yes.
So the mother to forgive
him. I'll tell you what. So, should I forgive someone who killed my child? Should I forgive somebody who abused my child? Because again, children. Should I abuse somebody who betrayed me? What do you mean by forgiveness? That you have to separate. There is punishment and there is forgiveness. Don't mix this up. Forgiveness meaning me personally, inside me, and this is high, high status, where I will pray for that person, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. And they will not do this to anybody else. But should that person be punished because of the crime? That's absolutely, that's the haqq of the community, right? If it is in your hand and people will look at you and says, if you forgive him, we will forgive him, then Allah put you in that status, which is actually, this is a concept in the deen. When someone kills someone, right? What is the punishment in this deen?
Death.
Unless the family forgive. If the family forgives, that person is not dead. That's higher level. And if you find this very difficult, go and read Surah An-Nur. Allah made you say this to wrap it here. What did they do to Sayyidah Aisha? Well, go, please go and read Surah An-Nur, second page of Surah An-Nur, one page, only one page, and read the commentary on this page. It's her, she is saying her story. Me and you are not Sayyidah Aisha. My father is not Abu Bakr, and my husband is not Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's enough, right? What did they accuse her of? I can't even say it. And you know all the story, right? Mm-hmm. And who accused her? The man spread the rumor, the man who Sayyidina Abu Bakr, her father, used to give him money and support him, right? The natural response is what? We'll never give him money. Natural, human beings, come on, right? What did Allah says?
You have to give more.
No, he didn't say give more. He did not tell him any of this in the Quran. He said, فَعْفُوا وَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Forgive and pardon. Don't you want Allah to forgive you? What did he respond? Oh, bala ya Rabbi, yes, I'll forgive and I will give more. That's Sayyidina Abu Bakr. That's the man who knows the Quran, lives by it. Did you see the point? If I ask it or I feel it the way you asked, the answer is no. Are you telling me I'm going to forgive somebody like this? It's very hard. Don't think this is easy. But when I have the knowledge, I hope now it's becoming easier. When I know the knowledge of the Quran, and when I read it, and I see what happens to Sayyidina Sayyida Aisha, the wife of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. Did you get the point? But the right of the society, I'm sorry, the right of the society, wherever you live, that right is left to the right of the people who has the right. But me personally, inside me, that's why the other one in Surah Al-Hashr, which I always love, رَبَّنَا لَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Ya Allah, don't put or don't leave in my heart, heart feeling, ill feeling toward any believer. Period, whatever they did. Because I want to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pure. طِبْتُمْ فَدْخُلُوهَا خَالِدِينَ. I want to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clean, pure. You didn't get what I said. You didn't get what I said. See, this is, don't let Shaitan do this to you. I didn't say forgive him and let him or her keep doing. I said there is two lines in here. There is me as a person, as a mother, as a friend, as a human being, and there is the right. This is between me and Allah. Allah will ask me about this. But there is the right of the community. The right of the community is there. That man has to be punished according to what the law is. My job is to, let's assume I know about it for sure, not talk. Be very careful. Very careful, for sure. Right? My job in front of Allah, I deliver the message to the people who are responsible. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ May Allah protect your children. Let's assume that's my child. Now stays the pain in me. I'm a mother. That's my child. Now here comes in. Can I forgive that person? That's very hard. I'm not going to say this is easy. But with the knowledge of the Quran, that's why I brought you the story of Sayyida Aisha. With the knowledge of the Quran, with knowing Allah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, with all the ayat, it becomes very easy. But the community has to be. Why the person who steals, the punishment in the Quran is cut their hand? If it was, forgive everyone. Did you see the point? So there's individual and there's communal right. Allah's right and communal right. We have to stop because it's almost 8:00. Jazakum Allahu khairan. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi tasliman kathira. Next week, inshallah, we will continue bi idhnillah.
We'll have
Tuesday.